You know, recently AICT announced the BTech Computer Science is now renamed as in specialized BTech Data Science program, BTech AI, BTech Cyber Security. So who is going to teach these subjects to the students? So in that connection, we are establishing an industry connect directly, and we are identifying the industry experts. We are discussing with them, and luckily we got a very good people connected through APSSDC, and they are very much interested offering the glimpse of subjects, the experience what they gained, the more than 20 plus of experience, and they are going to share with our faculty members. In fact, this is really, it's a very good opportunity for the faculty members. Good opportunity for you to upgrade your skills and to learn new skills, and that is going to be definitely helpful to our AP youth engineering students by directly getting a industry experienced people, KT knowledge transfer to the faculty members. You in turn go back to the college, and where you can your teaching is going to be changed with this faculty development program, where you can always thought about the application-oriented development teaching. So that is exactly our main aim, is to develop such type of environment so that you can teach always in industry perspective mode. So that once you teach that type of industry perspective mode, automatically student will able to get the fundamentals and subjects in advanced mode. Then for them it is easy to crack a MNC company or a good job in any company in India and globally. So that is the main objective. And today, it's a great privilege for me to introduce the BytExcel team. So this is the BytExcel team contacted me. It's like I would like to tell you in a 1 minute story. They contacted me through LinkedIn. And really, I'm very much impressed. The Pawan connected me through LinkedIn. He is from our state of Andhra Pradesh, and he wants to do something to our AP. So in that connection, straight away, we landed with this faculty development program in the name of cloud computing. So here, last, I think that 2 months or three months back, Pawan, before lockdown, we connected and we had a video conference through Zoom, and we had a lot of discussion on how we'll take it forward. And they have a very good platform, digital platform, that also we discussed. But finally, during this lockdown period, faculty members are ideal. I think this is the correct time to introduce this cloud computing course. So now here we have a team of BytExcel team, the panel resource persons. Here I would like to introduce Mr. Karan Thadepalli. He's a co-founder and CEO. Karan has over 18 years of experience, rich experience as a technology leader in leading team globally, building enterprise applications for large enterprises and startups, including learning platforms. So Mr. Karan, it's welcome. I'm introducing you to all the faculty members, about 300 plus today. And the Pawan. Mr. Pawan is a co-founder and CTO. The Pawan is a seasoned technology leader in cybersecurity. He is having a rich experience, more than 18 plus of years of experience in designing corporate and university bridge programs, building high performance tech teams, scaling technology enabled service platforms. And Charan, I think Charan is joined here today.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, so another big personality in the team of BytExcel, Sri Charan Thadepalli, is a COO. Charan is having more than 18 years of experience in industry leader in IT services with expertise in retail and aviation industries. So this is a great team with us, and I feel really our faculty members are so lucky enough to get a maximum flavor of the cloud computing by these leaders of co-founder and CEO, co-founder and CTO and COO. Pawan and Karan, Charan, so The session is like what we had earlier faculty development sessions. It's more to be, you know, interactive sessions. At the end of the session, you encourage, because it's a new technology for them, the faculty, in fact, which is not there in the part of curriculum. So whatever APSSDC, we are conducting the faculty development programs, which are new technologies, emerging technologies, which is not part of curriculum. So at the end of the session, you encourage the faculty members to answer question and session, question and answer session. Okay, so that they will learn the subjects by discussion. And also, I'm requesting all the faculty members, don't take it light. And just, you know, registering the cloud computing course, at the end of the course you think that you may get a certificate. See, certificate is not important. Getting the knowledge and gaining the knowledge is very important. So you go through the every session, because it's a great opportunity for you. You are directly interacting with this industry gain team. So whatever the assessments that are conducted at the end of the course, so obviously we'll introspect the assessment, and finally we'll issue the certificates. Okay, so don't think that just participating will get a certificate. So we need to introduce some yardsticks to issue a certificate. So this is at the last, I don't want to take much time. The main objective of the faculty development programs, introducing enriched technologies and latest technologies. This is a message of our Honorable Chief Minister. He wants to make it, our faculty is going to be strengthened. Our student going to get a good jobs. So in that perspective, you heard about Honorable Chief Minister recently in the newspapers announced, he wants to establish the best skill university. Total world is going to look into that skill university. In that also, we are introducing so many high-end skill technologies. So in that connection, the faculty members is going to get center of excellences is going to be established in these skill universities. The cloud center, cloud computing center of excellency, data center of excellency, AI center of excellency, which all are going to be come up in these skill institutes and skill universities that is directly accessible to the faculty members. We are in a discussion with HP India, TCS, and Deloitte and IBM. So very soon we'll get good many MNC companies going to these skill universities. Thank you very much, sir. So you please take it forward, Mr. Pawan, Karun, and Charan.
Thank you, Ravi Garu. It was a great introduction for us. Hello, everyone, and good morning, and welcome to the faculty development program organized by Andhra Pradesh State Skill Development Corporation and trained by Bitexcel. I want to start by thanking AP State Government for having this program that is going to benefit thousands of faculty and students by providing awareness, allowing them to catch up, learn, and excel with skills and technologies that are emerging every day in the world. Special mention to chairman of the skill development program, Mr. Challa Madhusudan Reddy Garu, for giving us this opportunity and the privilege to train all the participants today. I also want to thank Chief General Manager Ravi Gujula Garu for all the introduction and also on the coordination in this and organizing this event, along with Jagan and Sahitya for taking care of all the operations to enable this event go live today. Thanks. Please bear with us, like if there are any technical glitches, like today is our first session. So we'll be having it more sessions in this week. There is an overwhelming response than what we anticipated. The signups are more. So in case if you see if people are not able to log in or something, you'll be able to see us in Facebook Live. So we are streaming right now. I'll just give a quick introduction about Bitexcel. I know Mr. Ravi already told a lot of it, but I'll just walk through what the company is about and what we do. Bitexcel is a US-based company. Pawan and I, Ravi Garu introduced, we started this company in 2017, and very recently we launched in India along with our executive director, Mr. Raman, in December of 2019. It is a software as a service, SaaS experiential online learning platform with learning and skilling as primary focus. The platform is capable of online self-guided learning patterns and has reading materials, videos, hands-on labs, assessments, and discussion boards. You can meet with the experts, talk to the experts, and all that stuff in the discussion boards to get more awareness. Currently, there are like 20 plus programming languages, and we also offer instructor-led expert programming in career tracks like cloud DevOps, AI, ML, full stack development, QA automation, UI, and backend development. Bitexcel also partnered with Leading India AI, an initiative to promote and teach artificial intelligence. We are also a Microsoft partner for training. And also we partnered with various companies to help with the placement to start the career based on our individual skills and interests. There are more than 500 companies that hire through this platform. And so far, a few thousand people have been helped through the platform, through our partnerships and everything. As you can see, this is our management team. Ravi Garu already introduced about me, Karun, Pavan, and Charan. So I'll skip about our introduction and move on to our Chief Strategy Officer, Anil Chiravuru. He's a seasoned professional with over 30 plus years of experience. He worked as a senior vice president in multinational companies. He has vast experience in operations, sales, marketing, supply chain, etc. And he also has an MBA from IIM Lucknow. And as I said, we started Bitexcel in India through our partner, Mr. S.V. Ramangaru. He's our executive director. He has over 31 years of experience. He's an entrepreneur. He has been working with all the engineering colleges over the last 30 years to provide power systems and electrical lab equipment to all the colleges. So that's our team. And we have like cumulatively more than 100 plus years of experience. And we have been in industry for so long. So the idea is like we bring our expertise and try to provide it to, try to share it with all of you so that you learn something with all the emerging technologies that we have been focusing on all these years and try to share as much as we can. We'll do that in the next few days of this session. Next slide. Okay, I'll quickly go through the product offering. So basically, I think I already talked a bit. I won't take too much of time. But Explore is the online platform that I mentioned earlier, which has like 20 plus programming languages. And Expert is the instructor-led program. Where we train in a career path. It's not on individual programming languages, but it will be on a career track. For example, if you learn Python, we will show the direction how Python would be used in industry, such as how to become a data scientist or maybe a machine learning engineer or something like that. And real-time projects, the idea is to help the colleges, students, faculty, everyone to do this real-time projects. Allowing them to do some real projects, and it's not like a dummy project or something. When we say real projects, either by contributing it to the open source. Nowadays, like everything is open source because all the bigger industries are also relying on the open source stuff. So by contributing to the open source is one way, or maybe building applications or apps to a nonprofit organization is another way. And then moving on to this program, we will talk through the agenda. What we'll be doing in the next 5 days. We are in day one of the program. At day one, we are focusing on introduction, and we will be covering not only the introduction, but we'll talk about the cloud computing demand, the training overview, the services, the jobs, the how the job market is, and all those stuff. Along with that, we'll have a lab at the end to help you learn how to create an AWS account. Today, it will be mostly a theoretical session, but going forward in the next sessions, it will be purely, there will be a little bit of theory, but mostly hands-on learning. As you can see, there will be a couple of labs that you'll be doing. And our lab expert, Mr. Bhargav, would be helping after the session I talk through. So you'll be learning a lot of hands-on experience over this next few days on how to build this. On day two, we'll be talking about IAM, that is nothing but identity and access management, authentication and authorization controls. This will be explained by Pavan Gorakavi. Ravi Garu already explained, Pavan is an expert, comes from the cybersecurity world. So is the right person to talk about all the authentication, security, and all that. So those details will be coming in the second day. And again, Bhargav will be helping with the labs that you see on the screen over there. I would not reiterate them. Third day, we'll focus on compute and storage. And the topics that are covered in this one will be network security, elastic cloud computing, storage, and elastic beanstalk. And again, the labs list is over there. So there will be three labs in this session. And the session will be taken care by our CTO, Pawan Gorakavi. And the lab will be taken care by Bhargav. On day four, we will be focusing on databases. So basically, these databases, when we talk about, they are not the regular RDBMS, but on top of it, they are also part of the cloud. Something like RDS, DynamoDB, Redshift, Elastic Cache, and all these components. You'll get to learn, maybe these terms may be too overwhelming in the first session, but just remember these terms and we'll get deep and detail into each one of them. And again, there will be a couple of lab sessions like creating a Postgres instance and a DynamoDB in the AWS. We will help them and navigate through the lab also. We will end day five focusing on DevOps. I will give a glance of what DevOps is when we talk through. But the topics that would be covered in this DevOps will be the code build, code deploy, code commit, pipeline, CloudWatch, and the conclusion on that day. And Bhargav will be doing the lab on CloudWatch. So you get to have more hands-on experience on that day. So this is our agenda for the next 5 days. Next slide, Pawan. Okay. First, let's talk about why cloud. Why do we even need to talk about it today? The reason being, as you can see on the right side, the value proportion. By 2021, it is expected half of the Indian companies would be using hybrid cloud. And that number would go really fast in 1 or 2 years where all the companies will be on the cloud, whether it's a hybrid cloud, private, public cloud, we'll talk into those terms, but everything would be in cloud. And there is a huge need because all the industries are transitioning. So there will be huge demand in the market. As you can see, there will be 1 million jobs that will be created by 2022. IDC estimates, this is as per the IDC estimate. And more importantly, this is a number 7 emerging job in India right now. And very soon it will go up into the top 5. And the other aspect of it is, as you can see on the left side, based on the tech target in India today, here are the few analytics, what is the salary that can be expected in the cloud market. As you can see in US, the average is around $114,000 for all the cloud engineers. And if you see the peak over there, it even reaches $300,000. So that's the kind of a demand we have right now for cloud engineers. And also in India, a cloud engineer starts from, if he's an Azure or AWS consultant, starts at 9 lakhs and going all the way till 13 lakhs if you are an architect. We will talk about the roles and responsibilities in a few seconds, but this is the salary range. So basically, at the starting of the career, at the mid-level of the career, these are the salaries that we are talking about. And as if you become an administrator and all that, it will be even more higher. This is the average that we are looking at. That's one of the aspects of it. Next slide. Okay. Why cloud adoption is so high? Let's talk about that. Before we get into why the cloud adoption is so high, let's talk quickly why there is so much demand for cloud now. It's because why the cloud is started in first place. Earlier, maybe 2 decades ago, all the big corporations or any of the industries, they need to have their own data center. There is a huge infrastructure cost. For example, just give me a second. I'll grab some water. in order to have an infrastructure, so for example, we are talking about huge list stack of servers, like maybe mainframe servers and all that, which could be afforded only by the big corporations, like a multi-billion dollar companies or something. Others were not even able to think about starting a new company or anything. It was handled only by huge corporations. So that's when the thought about the cloud has helped in. And also the most important aspect is around 2007, there were two great innovations that have happened. One, Apple launching an iPhone. And similarly, almost maybe in a 1 or 2 years range, Amazon coming up with AWS. What has happened because of that is Apple iPhone gave us a smartphone that can give the applications running on a handheld device. Earlier, it was a computer or a tablet. If you want to browse something, you have to go to a computer or a tablet. Whereas with the iPhone, with the smartphones, everything came into your hands. After the smartphone, the tablets came. And I don't have to talk about all the digitization we have right now. Even TV, everything is a digital thing right now. So that's how the transition has happened. In order to support all these apps and everything, the biggest advantage they had was a cloud, something called cloud, which was taking care of all the infrastructure, backend, and all that stuff was developed by Amazon. So the combination of these two things kind of revolutionized the market. Just to think about it, if there was no smartphone, think about it. There are a lot of companies that you might have not even heard about it. For example, Uber or Ola, even to certain extent like Netflix and all these companies, they came into existence only because of the smartphone. And at the same time, the infrastructure that is available on the back, which is called the cloud. Let me take an example and explain the cloud and how do you get all these benefits that you are seeing around the cloud, like the flexibility, cost efficiency, and all that stuff. So for example, now, especially in this pandemic, right, everyone is sitting at home. The only source of entertainment might be the digital platforms. It's a blessing in disguise, but it kind of helping us keep us engaged, have something to watch on the TV and all that stuff. And the reason we are able to do that is because of the infrastructure that came up. So when we talk about that, I don't know if you guys know it or not, but Netflix as a backend uses AWS as their service, for the cloud infrastructure and everything. What do they get out of this? As a digital streaming, they have the flexibility. So basically the flexibility in the sense they can decide what kind of a servers they want, what the bandwidth they need, the speed they need, and all these can be defined on the moment. For example, in a Hotstar, if you are watching a live cricket game, if it is an India-Pakistan game or maybe an India and Australia game, the viewership will be really high. So at that time, they can decide about this scalability, flexibility, and all that stuff. So scalability, for example, during that time, we assume there will be almost 100 million people watching the TV. And rest of the time, Hotstar, they may be only 1 million people that are regularly watching every day. How do they scale during this time? It all comes because of the cloud infrastructure that they have. They can increase the number of servers or decrease the number of servers as they go. And that's one of the reasons maybe, you guys might have observed in Amazon Prime, or maybe some pay-per-view kind of movies that they are coming right now. So if you watch a movie, you pay the money because that's when the companies are incurring the cost. That's where they are trying to put a price. You don't have to pay if the consumer is not watching any movie or something. So that's a flexibility we talk about. And then how is it cost efficient? Like I said, even for the servers and infrastructure, you pay based on the pay-per-use. You don't have to pay them if you are not using. For example, like I said, 2 decades ago, for example, take any financial industry, the biggest of the banks like Bank of America in India, or maybe something like Bank of America in US or ICICI in India. Those are the kind of banks who were able to easily manage them, the big organization, because they are always maintaining the servers, the infrastructure. Even a data center needs a lot of inventory in terms of real estate and everything also. So only the big companies were able to handle. So But when it came to the cloud, now even the smallest of the companies, like I was talking about Netflix that came into existence at a later point of time, they can decide, or even Hotstar, like which came into existence like 5 years, decide when they want to use or when they don't want to use, how much they want to pay, and all those kind of things. So that's where the cost efficiency would come into picture. Security. As we talked about, like we will talk more about the security in the next coming slides, but just give you an overview. It was the responsibility of the individual companies to take care of the security, because they are the ones who are managing all the servers. For example, the databases that they maintain, it's a responsibility of the individual company to take care of the security. The masking of data and all these things we talk about. But with cloud, what has happened is now the biggest of the organizations like Amazon, Microsoft, or Google Cloud, who have the good expertise on the security, they will be managing most of the security and letting us to follow the directions that were given. So that makes the life easy for a lot of organizations. That's where it comes into. And mobility, like we talked about, now you don't need huge infrastructure or huge data center so that the companies can cut the cost on that. They were paying so much for the electricity bill, the real estate, which is the rents and everything. So those kind of things. And there is a lot of mobility. So for example, maybe a company starts being a customer of Amazon and later on they find something that they need not available over there, or maybe they are part of Microsoft. They can switch between different clouds. I'll talk more about that in detail also. And over the next few days, you'll hear like how do you switch from one cloud to other and all that. I already focused on the scalability aspect of it. Like I was saying, Hotstar, when there is a cricket match, when the servers, huge speed and network is available and all those kind of things will decide the scalability, whether you need hundreds of servers or thousands of servers, or you can just run with 10 servers or 20 servers will decide your scalability. Depending on the demand, they can decide that. And again, low cost of ownership, like I said, everything became, it's no more a CapEx, it turned out to be an operational expenditure. So basically the companies have diverted the infrastructure cost onto, it's still an infrastructure cost, but they have diverted into pay-per-use model instead of putting a lot of money at the beginning of the, or during the setup of the organizations. Next slide, Paul. Okay, one more. So basically talking about all that before going to jobs, roles, and responsibilities. And because of all these flexibilities that come with the cloud, the adoption has gone up by leaps and bounds. Like I was talking about earlier, there were only big organizations that we were able to afford the data centers and build this kind of infrastructure. But now, every small company, or maybe even at the smallest of the startups, like if we decide to come up, there are companies which can help in giving the infrastructure. And this is a quote from Jeff Bezos when he was asked like, what was the reason or how do you want to help the future? He did mention that cloud is one of the things that they created as a platform. So for example, having an infrastructure like AWS allowed someone like Mark Zuckerberg sitting in a dorm of his university able to build a company like Facebook. Imagine if Amazon is a $1 trillion company, Facebook is more than $500 billion now. And it was totally built on something like infrastructure like AWS. That's the kind of flexibility that cloud is giving. Initially, it was adapted only by the small and mid-range companies, but over the years, even the bigger organizations have seen the benefits of this one so that they can reduce the CapEx that I've been talking about. And I will explain more during the public private cloud and all that we talk about. So that's the reason there is so much of a need for cloud and everything. Now, let's look into the jobs and responsibilities, right? What are the kind of jobs that are available in a being for a cloud professional? Will come from the bottom up. Like one is a DevOps engineer. So basically, what is a DevOps? So basically, it's kind of an combination of two words, development and operations. Like I was talking about 2 decades ago, there were two separate teams. One is for development and another is the operations. And then everyone was following a waterfall methodology. So basically, like if an organization decides to build a new component or a new product into the company, they used to follow this waterfall model where they would take 6 to 12 months to build a product and 2 months to test it and then go into the production. But in case if there are any failures or anything that happens after the 12 months, it would have delayed the release and all that stuff. So the methodology, all the companies have moved from waterfall to agile. In order to adapt to this agile methodology, which is like build at the earliest possible and find the if there are any roadblocks or any blockers, find at the early stage. That's the concept of agile methodology. And this DevOps really helped in putting it in the right perspective. So what has happened is the development and operations came together in order to plan in such a way where development will happen in parallel with the development. I'll talk more in detail on the DevOps in the next few slides when we talk about that. But that's one of the roles over there. And next one is the cloud security engineer. Like I was talking earlier during the cloud, it will be the responsibility of the cloud security engineer to take care of a security. In any organization, the biggest risk is security, the loss of data, because the companies will be sued for millions of dollars and all that. And that was the reason why most of the big organizations were the last adopters of the cloud. Before like all the startup mid-range companies came in, even today there are some few financial sector that are still slowly migrating into the cloud, and the reason being the security. But what has happened with this cloud is they came up with this cloud, like I was talking about, the experts were able to design the security over there. There were guidelines that were coming up from them, and based on the guidelines, a security engineer will be able to put all the patches that are needed and everything. And on top of it doesn't mean that the responsibility would be sitting on the cloud. There are hundreds of steps to be taken care of by the cloud security engineer. We will talk when Pavan will give a session tomorrow, when there is authentication, authorization, and then the security aspects come in day two and day three. Now I'll move on to cloud architect. So again, it's just not enough that you have a cloud infrastructure over there. You need an architect to understand the need. So for example, like I was talking about that, let's take the example of Hotstar itself, right? So during the normal hours, they need to know what is the capacity, how many servers are needed, what kind of load balancers are required. And those kind of details will be taken into consideration. And cloud architect is the one who will be able to build the infrastructure. And then, and also he will be the person who will be able to foresee when there is a huge demand. So basically the fluctuation, when I was talking about increasing the servers, decreasing the servers and all that thing, will be taken care by a cloud architect. Okay, he will be the one, basically as the name itself says, he will be the one who is going to plan everything. And then cloud engineer. Like as description says, he is responsible for addressing the technical issues of a platform. Even though the cloud will be handled by an organization such as AWS, Azure, or Google, still there will be some components that needs to be taken care by the individual organization who is running on the cloud. Like I said, the smallest of the patches that come through, maintaining them regularly, or maybe the setup of the how the load balance should work and all those kind of technical details will be taken care of by a cloud engineer. It's one of the good responsibilities and a great job where they get to understand the whole perspective right from the coding all the way to the production environment. And then cloud developer. This one is actually building the cloud application. So as the architect designs, he comes up with all the components like we discussed about everything. The cloud developer will be the one who will be implementing that. Okay. And then cloud administrator. So as the name itself says, he's an administrator. He is responsible for managing the cloud. So basically, again, I'll be talking more about public clouds, private clouds, and the hybrid cloud, and all those things, community cloud. I will explain how the responsibility vary for each kind of a role or each kind of a platform. So if it is a public platform, there are certain things that to be taken care of, and private cloud. So we'll talk more about the cloud administrator. But just think for now, administrator is the one who will be taking care of the whole the cloud infrastructure and everything. Pawan, next slide. Okay. I will give you just a roadmap, how do you get into a cloud career? So basically, I was talking about multiple jobs and responsibilities, right? There is a cloud engineer, there is a cloud architect, there is an administrator and all that. So each one will maintain certain components of it. And at the same time, when we talk about cloud, there is one slide at the end. But when we talk about cloud, it's a combination of a lot of components in it. For example, the simplest of these things is maybe having something like a storage, or maybe having a web server and having a database. These are all the components of the cloud. What we need to do as the ground bottom platform, the ground level, is understanding what the components are and try to build a foundation on top of it. Just because you are a cloud engineer, it doesn't mean that you know everything. There are hundreds of components. You need to master some of those components. And it's good to identify what those components and build the foundation on that. And once you identified and have a foundation, it's very important to get a hands-on experience. And this can be done only through a real-time project. Like I was talking about, maybe either contributing to the open sources or maybe building some real-time equipment or something for home. For example, you can build a security camera to your home by yourself using some of the components that are already available in the cloud. We will talk and we'll try to explain as much as can during this workshop so you guys can understand if there is something that we can build by ourselves. Sitting at home, one of the simplest is maybe the security cameras that the basic model can be created very easily. So doing those real-time projects is very important to understand the case. And today we will start by creating an AWS account, and then we slowly go from one step to another. And the next important part is reading industry blogs. So basically all these companies, they come up with the blogs. Even Bytexel will come up with a newsletter. In the next slide, I'll talk more about that. But trying to get all this expert advice and how the cloud is changing every day, what are all the new emerging technologies that are being supported by cloud, we need to have the understanding. And this can be done only by reading these industry blogs. And next component is obviously, in order to say that you have been through all these steps and you know something, getting a certification is kind of a validity. One, two, and for individual like ourselves, to feel that we have accomplished something, we learned so and so. So the certificates are offered by all these companies. Again, AWS offers their certificate for their cloud. Azure, Microsoft offers the Azure cloud. And similarly, Google and Oracle does that too. Once you have this certification, all the expertise, the last step, but the most important one, I know, will be the finding a matching job. Which interests? So basically, building foundation is very important, because that way we can make a career based on your choice, what you are interested in, and then they decide what you are getting into. So that way, getting into a career by knowing will be a lot valuable when we grow in the company. For example, you start at level zero. At that point, it doesn't matter. You're just looking for a job. But once you get into the job, you'll realize there will be hardships. But if you have an understanding what you are getting into, I think your level zero to level one, level two, everything will become a lot more smoother. Next slide, Pawan. Okay, let's talk about the learning path. How do we get into this learning path and the steps I talked about finding a match, what you need to do. So basically, first thing is we need to have an understanding of the operating system. Everybody would be using your laptops and everything, right? For most of the machines might be either Windows or Mac if it is an those are the, on top of it for programming, the most used is either Linux or Unix. These are the most friendly operating systems for a programmer to develop any of the components. So it's good to have an understanding. It is very good to have an understanding on all these operating systems that will help the foundation good. And then coming to the networking, you need to know what the fundamentals of networking, what is a LAN, like local area network, wide area network, public private networks, right? So the security plays an important role over here, which one should be exposed to the world, what we can't expose to the world will be decided. And also cryptography. I think most of the people might be already learning the cryptography in their engineering curriculum or as part of it, but there are very detailed nuances. So understanding all those would help over here. And then coming to the programming languages, right? It's always good to master one programming language, whether it's like a Python, Shell script, Java, it doesn't matter, but understanding and having a great in-depth knowledge of one of these programming language will help you scale your career path. Once you know the basics of the programming language, there are a lot of bells and whistles that come into the picture at later point of time in the industry. For example, if you learn Python, Python has so many open source components. I'll just throw some names. Maybe you can write it down. For example, like NumPy, Pandas, and all those kind of packages. So you need to understand all these bells and whistles to see how they can be incorporated with Python or included with the Python as add-ons and what we can achieve with that. So I'm sure we'll talk more it's part of the artificial intelligence machine learning, but that's the kind of thing you'll get to understand. Having a good, strong Python skills or any of the programming languages will help you take forward. And next, as I said, doing a real-time project. It is very important. So for example, so in order to do a real-time project, you need to have an understanding of the architecture of the clouds. So okay, in our session, we'll touch some of the components of the AWS architecture. We won't be touching Azure, but AWS is the most widely used and there are a lot of components that we'll talk about. Having this understanding, and also like I was throwing an example where you can build your own security camera or something, it's a basic version. I'm not talking about the advanced version, but so in order to even build those kind of things, you need to understand what components you can use and all that stuff. And then GitHub, Git kind of changed the whole version control system, where it made a lot easier for the source code commits and all that stuff. We'll talk a little bit in the DevOps section and also maybe in the final day, there will be a lot of discussion points on GitHub and all the deployments and all this stuff. So GitHub is the place where all the source code lives. And also it is also a place where you can get the open source community code, the plugins that I was talking about and all this can be, you can get there. Like I said, today we'll start with creating a test account. So you'll learn that one. And the other aspect is like I was talking about reading the industry blogs like devops.com, TechCrunch or even Bitexel newsletter. What these newsletters will bring or the blogs bring to you is basically the advances that are happening in cloud. So cloud will be constantly changing. The reason being they will come up with a new innovation. Even if it is not an innovation, it can be a simple enhancement. For example, if you are using the servers that are not able to scale up to more than 10 million people, or maybe the performance is not great when there are 10 million on the platform, the performance of the app is going down. In those kind of things, what are all the changes that are happening? When you go through these industry blogs, newsletters, you'll understand what are all the advances that are coming through, which will help you in implementing in your day-to-day needs. So it's very important to know what are the latest updates. And next one is, I already talked about it, getting a certification. Right now, AWS does provide the certification for their cloud, Azure, Microsoft does provide Amazon, and even Bitexcel, like we do have some certification programs. We'll talk about that. So once you do all this stuff, again, it comes to the point where you are finding a job based on your certifications, based on the knowledge you have gained. For example, you became an expert with one of the programming languages. Your career will be in a component of the whole DevOps process. We'll talk about each individual components, but that's where we'll be. Or if you are a network expert, okay, you'll be there. So depending on the jobs and roles as responsibility we talked about earlier, that's where you'll be fitting into. So that's like a very important understanding, like which component you are more interested in and where you want to focus your energies on. Guys, let me know if I'm going too fast. Let me know so I can slow down a little bit. And just a reminder, I can always post the questions in chat or Q&A. We'll try to answer at the end of the session. Okay. Now we talked about the job demand, the kind of job roles and responsibilities in cloud, and the learning path and everything. Now let's talk about the actual cloud and what are all the components that are involved. Okay. So introduction to cloud computing. So basically, like I was talking about, cloud computing is an on-demand availability of required computing resources. So in order to achieve the day-to-day tasks, so basically, when I say day-to-day task, like the example that I was quoting, when you are watching in a movie in a Netflix or watching a cricket match in the Hotstar, those are the kind of things that would decide that your demand at the peak hours, how you need to do and all that. And this is a part of the scalability and the biggest advantage of the cloud. You can scale up really fast. And if there is no need, you can scale down really fast. So, and also, like I was talking about, the most important component you need to underline here is the on-demand availability. There is always infrastructure available for you to consume. So that's a given. And so basically, if you see the demand surging, all these organizations, they automatically will bump you to the next level in order to handle. So that's the reason, like, Netflix or any of these companies have 99.9% availability. You never see them going down or anything. Like if you look at 5 years ago, when there is a huge demand surge or something, the servers would crash and all that. But now it happens in a very rare scenario. And the reason being is because of this one, on-demand availability. And that also count to this point of flexibility. Cloud computing is flexible. So you decide what you need. And at the same time, depending on the demand and everything, the flexibility happens, the scalability happens, the servers. So there are a lot of things, like, for example, just to throw some names, if you take an EC2 server, there will be something like a T2 large, T3 max, T1 micro and all that. There are like, are you guys still able to hear me?
Yeah, Karan, we are able to hear you. Go ahead.
Yeah. So basically, that's a kind of flexibility we are talking about. And the next important thing is cloud computing is available on web. Like I was quoting an example of a smartphone, right? Like iPhone or any of the Android devices or any phone that you have right now. The reason you are able to access anything through a web is because there is behind this cloud infrastructure. The combination of this app, the smartphone, and the cloud is boon to the world. Everything is coming to picture. Let me explain about the current crisis also, right? Like during this COVID time, I know the governments had to do the lockout and all that, the social distancing and all these things have to be followed. In order to do that, and also the companies like Google and Apple are coming together in US, I don't know if how it is in India right now, but in US, at least these companies have come together in order to create this contact tracing. So basically, if you are using a phone, it would be able to identify whether like a person has a temperature or something like that, or if the people are maintaining a 6 feet distance or not. Those kind of things were easily trackable. And this is happening because of the web that is accessed through the phones and the cloud infrastructure that is available right now. So it's a great combination. And there are a lot of wonders are happening because of that. Yeah. Next slide, Pawan. Okay. So I'll talk in the next slide on the client-server architecture. But as you can see, like I was talking about, assume either it's a PC or a mobile phone or a tablet is the client. The browser will be your client. Let me grab some water. So basically, the browser in any of these devices or an app in any of these devices is a client. And when you make a request, for example, you are doing a Google search to find out, for example, like what is the nearest theater you have, or the if you want to find the movie list or something, you just Google it. And then the request goes to the server. That's where it's fetched from. And all this is happening in fraction of a second. And that's because of the power of the cloud computing right now. The infrastructure that is available on the back end, and at the same time, the capability of all these mobile devices. For example, like people who know, like two decades ago, that talking about a 1 gig is like the biggest of the things. But now terabyte is also nothing. Even smallest of the USB devices are having a terabyte of data. And I don't have to talk about the mobile devices. Like, yeah, all the mobile devices, they come with an additional SD card, micro SD cards, which can easily take up like 128 gig and all that. Imagine even if the mobile devices can hold up so much of data and everything. That's the power of this client-server architecture. Pawan, next slide. Okay, let's talk about the components, right? In the client-server architecture, client is a gadget to request data from the server. Like I was talking about, browser is kind of a thing, or maybe your app on the phone. That's a gadget, and that's where the request is made together. And the client is end user with required information. And your required information was the example I quoted, to find the nearest movie theater, or maybe the any movie playing during that time or something, whatever the request might be, or even finding the cricket score would be the end user required information. And server is something which picks requests and responds. So now you asked, like, there is a cricket match going on and you want to find out how much Virat Kohli has made, or maybe what the score of India. That's the request, and that's the information that's coming from the server. So even websites like Crickinfo and all that, like they have become a lot better in the last few years because of this digitization that we talked about and all this evolution. You can find variety of servers. There is a typo, spelling mistake. Sorry for that, guys. You can find variety of servers like a web server, file server, database servers to respond to the client request. So for example, like I was talking about, web servers is something where the applications are deployed into. File server can be something like the storage. For example, take an example of Facebook. Instagram is the latest example, right? People will be posting bunch of photos, and then there is some caption to that photos and all that, right? And all this data will be saved in something like a file server. Example will be S3 storage in AWS. I will talk about that. A web server can be an EC2. And database servers, obviously database is required for everything. All the data will be sitting in the database. And AWS comes up with RDS, DynamoDB are some of the things that they support. And these are the components that are used to the client server architecture. So basically fetch the data that you are looking for. Next slide, Pawan. Okay, now let's talk about like what is on-premise and what is a cloud, right? I was giving you examples of like two decades ago that big corporations like the banks, they were holding their own data centers and everything, right? So basically that's a kind of a thing where we talk about on-premise. There is a version of cloud also, we'll talk about that, something called private cloud, but for now just focus on this one, on-premise. So basically, the idea is when it is on-premise, it's the responsibility of that particular company to manage all the resources, and it's their responsibility to take care of the support and functionality. It can be a database support. It can be the web servers, the file servers that we talked about. Everything was maintained by this. So there used to be a lot of admin jobs during that time. For example, WebLogic, right now it's been acquired by Oracle. There will be a lot of WebLogic admins and all those people who were maintaining and all that. Then there were database administrators. These jobs still exist, but in a different way in the cloud. And there are some people still handling this on-premise. For example, most of the financial sectors, even in US, like right now, they're still on-premise. Okay. And whereas in the cloud, you can see that managed by the cloud service provider. So on the on-premise, it will be the responsibility of a company. Whereas in a cloud, it will be the responsibility of the cloud. For example, in case of Netflix, AWS, like I said, is the infrastructure. So it will be the responsibility of AWS to maintain, make sure that the data that they are trying to fetch is available 99.99% of the time. And again, there's a typo, sorry guys. Maintain separate IT team to manage the infrastructure. Okay. So I was talking about, there used to be the IT programmers and everyone. On top of that, you have administrators and everyone to take care of these kind of things. So it is the responsibility of the organization to have all the programmers, all the administrators. That's why there are two large teams we are talking about, right? The development team and the operations team and all that. And whereas in the cloud, the infrastructure will be maintained by the cloud service provider. Like I said, still there will be some part that needs to be done by these organizations who are using the cloud, but it will be based on the guidelines that we receive from a particular cloud. Okay. And then we talked about the flexibility aspect of the cloud, right? The biggest advantage of the cloud is the being on demand and the flexibility. And it's a big constraint on the on-premise side. As you can see, once you have a data center, right, and your capacity is filled, for example, let me make up a point, like they have only 100 gig of data and they are supporting, let's say, 16 gig of RAM or something like that. These are small numbers, but I'm just throwing an example. If they have to go from 100 gig into 500 gig is a big aspect by itself. 10 years ago, all these kind of maintenance and everything, or maybe the scaling up, would have taken at least 3 to 6 months of time. And also there used to be a lot of outages. Maybe when they're doing this, the hardware upgrades and everything, they have to lose the business. Like for example, most of the companies would have a notice saying, we are down from so-and-so time, like on the weekends, like Saturday and Sunday, we'll not be able to. And this is after all the planning, design, implementation, testing, and everything. I'm talking about the production outage. So that was a big constraint, and that's where the cloud is catching up and people are understanding the need. And next one, it is more costly, like server hardware, power consumption, and space. Like I was saying, if you are talking about, just to give an example, if you have to have a data center, it would be as big as a cruise ship. Imagine a cruise ship that's carrying 400 to 500 passengers. A data center would be that big for any of the bigger organizations, even Apple or maybe the banks that we are talking about, like Bank of America or any of these things. They need to have such a big real estate in order to handle all this, the servers and everything. And now with the cloud, we don't have to take care of it. It's been taken care of by the provider. So as you can see, we can only pay for what we use. So these are the advantages, and those are the prime differences that we need to understand about the cloud and the on-premise. And looking at this, you can easily understand why the industry is shifting towards the cloud. When I made a point like by 2021, half of the companies in India would be moving to cloud because it's a no-brainer. As you can see, the costs have been going down so much. Instead of spending all the cost on the infrastructure, then now they can put that money on the innovation or maybe providing more employment. We are talking about employment in the sense being a cloud engineers or maybe any of the tools or anything. So that's where the cost is changing from being an capital expenditure to an operational expenditure. Next slide, Pawan. Okay. Now, I've been mentioning these words for quite some time now, like public cloud, private cloud, community cloud, and hybrid cloud. Now we'll just quickly look into the aspect of this one, how do we do a deployment? Okay, that will be talked in detail in the day five, but I'll just quickly walk through what this public, private, community, and hybrid clouds are and what the deployment process we are talking about. Next slide, Pawan. Okay, as you can see, public cloud, it is service provided by the third party through web and we can pay as we use. So like I was talking about, let's say you are in a company like Uber or Ola, right? And then what we are doing is we are leveraging a cloud from AWS, right? So the infrastructure is provided by them. You have all the resources needed, like the database and everything. Depending on the demand, you will just leverage that one. So when I say that, for example, there will be a standard cost involved. When I say flexibility, it doesn't mean that you'll be at zero or at 100. When I say, when you start, you need a database. For example, your database has 21 tables, the schema has 21 tables, and then it has already 10,000 people on the platform. So let's assume it consumes around 110 gig of data. So basically your requirement starts at that. I have a 10 gig of data. I have a schema like this. So the database RDBMS, you build it on that one. And then on top of it, you know that you have a programming language. For example, you have coded everything in Java and you need a server like EC2 where you would deploy your code. So these are the basic things that you know. And then on top of it, you'll know you need to know how many servers you need. For example, let's say you need two servers because in case one goes down, there is another to hold the resource or to do the round robin and all that stuff. So basically, these are the basic minimum requirements you need to know. And from there, you scale up. So when I say public cloud deployment and you have the flexibility to scale up, the base will be there. That's what the cloud architect would define. And then you take that. And then on top of it, you do the deployment. So that's where the DevOps team in a company would come into to do the programming, do the deployment and the infrastructure provided by the third party. And there is very less maintenance from the individual perspective, organization perspective, because this is all part of the public cloud. They are taking care of the infrastructure and everything. You are just giving their requirements to that. Whereas when you look at the private cloud deployment, right? It is a cloud deployment managed by a single organization. So what I am saying is here, for example, I am a company, a financial sector, let's say one of the most secure things I can think of is maybe a bank. So for example, a bank or anything, right? They generally try to keep it to themselves. They don't want to share the infrastructure with another companies because of the security concerns. For some reason, if there is a security lapse by any of these cloud providers, if they don't trust, that's when they go with the private cloud. So in this model managed for a single organization, either it is located at the company's on-site or data center, or is managed by the third party vendor. It can be AWS, they can be maintaining it for them. But this infrastructure will be totally given for a particular organization. It will be taken care by them. Whereas a hybrid cloud, as the name itself says, it's a combination of public and private. Again, in the example of banks or something, right? There are certain things which can be public. For example, information to educate the people about the savings account, or maybe to tell that there is a account that you, if you put your money like a 10% or something, these are all the educational or informative information. They can all sit in the public cloud. They may not feel that the security is of much of a vulnerability, or maybe they are not worried about sharing the data. In those cases, they choose public, whereas the private cloud will be chosen when they feel that there is a need for a lot of security or something, because like individual bank accounts, right? Like you don't want someone to know the your bank balance or something. So the bank, in order to maintain their identity and also to have a control on things, they will go for private. So that can be a case of where they go for a hybrid cloud deployment, where they have both public and private cloud. I kind of simplified it easily so that you can understand, but there are a lot of aspects to this hybrid cloud also. We'll talk in the next few sessions. And then next part is the community cloud deployment. So community cloud is kind of where similar kind of industries come together. This is an kind of an interesting, maybe I'll talk a little bit of a blockchain over here. I don't want to go deep into, but for example, there are, you guys might have heard about Bitcoins and all that stuff, right? Like they have been rage for last couple of years, like they are kind of creating their own economic system also. So something like a Bitcoin, right? It can be sold and purchased with different people. So something like there are a lot, each country has their own set of companies or something. What they can do is they can be part of this community. So let's assume a combination of these companies who sell and purchase the Bitcoins can come together. They form a community and have this community cloud deployment, because the reason being they have the same vested interests and they are into the similar kind of business. And also they need not create a lot of things. For example, there is something called the concept of wallet. That's where the mining would happen in order to get a token and all that. Don't worry, guys. Like if you are not understanding or if you haven't heard about Bitcoin or anything, the whole concept is what I'm trying to explain is if they have a similar pattern, I want to share the understanding. So in those cases, it would be easy. The reason I took the example of Bitcoin is because the mining would be pretty standard. As a standard, Bitcoin will have like maybe assume like there are 10 million Bitcoins in the world right now. So each one will be taking a part of pie of that one. So that's the reason it's kind of community cloud. That's the easiest example I could think. But there are a lot of other things also. Maybe nonprofit organizations could come together, or even some of the banks can come up with that. For example, during this pandemic, there are a lot of governments in the world. They are giving this protection plan to the small business or something. So they can leverage these kind of community platforms to educate the people and everything. Okay. So this is a hybrid cloud structure, right? Like I already explained, I won't go again too much into detail, but you can see there are two components, public and private cloud. They form this hybrid cloud. There can be like, you can see the data coming into the private cloud and at the same time into the public cloud from this hybrid cloud. Okay. Next slide, Paul. So like I explained, hybrid cloud is a combination of public and private cloud, including on-premise resources. So for example, like a private cloud can be within your data center. When I say you are in the organization, okay? It's a combination of that. Public cloud is easy to manage and provider takes care of everything. We talked about how it is being done already. We will, when we start doing our labs and going deep into this session, you'll understand more on how the existing infrastructure is helping it. I just don't want to say again that it's very easy, but you will understand how the AWS components are AWS services, similarly Azure components are services helping you guys to in the public cloud sector. The example of Bitcoin and blockchain I was talking about, right? For example, if you build a blockchain application, Amazon came up with something called AWS managed blockchain services. So basically what they did was like, there are certain components which are common to every deployment, right? They take all those components, they standardize the process. So 50% of the deployment or the 50% of the thing will be taken care of AWS, and the remaining floating points will be taken care by the individual. So that's kind of an example where we are talking about where the cloud making it easy. They are coming up with these components and all that stuff. So for example, you don't have to worry about like if you are doing something similar to a LinkedIn or a Facebook, you need not worry how do I store all my pictures, or maybe how where do I store all the data that is coming. Those are the kind of things that it makes very easy. Next one is private cloud or on-premise is like organization. They are responsible for everything in the resources within the company. So again, like I said, once the organization decides that they don't want to share with the third party vendors, or they want to be by them managed everything by the individual company, especially like in the financial sector or the government organizations, those will be taken care by the individual organization. Again, they will have all these roles of administrators, developers, and everything will be the responsibility of the private cloud, the organization that's maintaining the private cloud. Next one. Okay. So before I just dwell into this serverless architecture, I just want to talk quickly about DevOps and give some basic points for you. So that remember these keywords and you will learn more on the fifth day. For example, like I talked about DevOps, right, where development and operations are coming together. There are multiple components in this one, like continuous integration, continuous delivery, continuous deployment. So what does that mean? What is a continuous integration? Don't get confused. Basically, what they are trying to mean is, as in the word integration says, there are a lot of components involved in bringing an application into production environment. Let's take example of an app that we are trying to build. For example, maybe Zomato or a Swiggy, right? Zomato or a Swiggy is an app. There are multiple ways that you can build an app. In one, you build a native apps. For example, when I say native apps, that means building an app that is very specific to the Android phones, and one the very specific to the iOS, which is the which caters to the iPhones. Okay. And then there is the third component called hybrid apps. Something like Ionic would help in creating an app that can be deployed into all the phones. It doesn't matter whether you're using a Windows phone, Redmi, which has an Android versions, or maybe the Samsung phones, iPhones, it doesn't matter. So that's an hybrid kind of a thing. So basically what I'm trying to say is like, think of building an app, right? For an example. In order to build an app, first you need to write some code. For example, the UI UX will be done in some kind of a language like Angular or maybe React. So on. They are the front-end components that are involved. And then there is a back-end component, something like middleware and a database, right? So we talked about these components also. Middleware, like Java is one of the biggest middlewares that in the world right now. And also nowadays, microservices, Node.js, and all these components are also coming. So there are a lot of them. So basically, the first component is programming, which is building this Angular UI component in connection with the database in order to put a request, fetch a data from the database. Okay, this is a programming aspect of it. And the next one is unit testing. So basically, in order to make sure whatever you are coding makes sense, you need to have a unit test. So basically, that's another component of it. So unit testing is another. So programming plus unit testing will form the development aspect of it. And then after that, then you have something called the version control. I was talking about GitHub, right? Where the companies or the organization, whatever the code they write, they have to put it in the source control, which will be commonly accessed by all the developers. At the same time, if they want to share with the open source community any of the components, they can also leverage like open source components. In order to get that, maybe use something like a GitHub, where all the code is, your code is also checked in, and it can be private folders. You don't have to share it with the world. Yours will be private, but that's where the, so GitHub will be there. So programming, then unit testing, checking into a something like a GitHub, which is an version control system. And then we talk about something like a Jenkins, which is, okay. Let me know if it is better now. And then something like Jenkins, which would allow to do the automation of the builds. For example, every time you write a code, you don't have to manually go and deploy code into the server. The servers we talked about, like EC2 or anything. So what we can do is like we can have this something like a Jenkins, which automates a lot of stuff for us to do a deployment. And this is where the control comes. The continuous integration is the aspect where we integrated development, the unit testing, the checking the code into a version control, the automation of the deployment, and then even QA. I forgot on that aspect, but QA, where the testing will be done. So this is a continuous integration. Once you start at this point, the end point is at the end of testing. So this is continuous integration. Now comes the component of continuous delivery or continuous deployment. Let's talk about continuous deployment, right? So now I did my development. I have to test whether it's working in my dev environment. In any industry, there will be multiple environments. Generally, the most standard are a dev environment. Next one will be staging environment and production. So basically, like you see, there are multiple environments. So in order to test, I stop at development environment to make sure whatever I have, the code that is written by a developer is working well. And then it moves on to the QA team, where they would test. QA team is also part of this DevOps team now. These are not separate teams like earlier. So QA would test it and certify. And once they say, okay, it is looking good, then it moves on to the next level, maybe into the staging environment. And at the staging environment, this is where you need to get production approvals before going live, because that's where the management will look into it and all that stuff, right? I would not go much into detail, but I'm just giving you an high overview. So basically, remember these words like continuous integration and then the continuous deployment. The deployment is happening into the dev environment, into the staging environment, and there are some audits over there will be taken care by the administrative teams before putting into the production. And even if that one is achieved, then we have a continuous delivery. So these are the three steps: continuous integration, deployment, and delivery. Remember, we'll talk like when we are going to it. I just saw a question. Like I said, today's theory will be like there will be a lot of theory. Just remember, you get to hear a lot of buzzwords. But from tomorrow, there will be one lab session today, but from tomorrow you'll see more of lab sessions coming through. And then next one is cloud service providers, right? Like I already talked about like hundreds of times in the conversation the last 1 hour. So basically these three are the biggest players right now. Amazon is the number one, and Azure, Microsoft Azure is a close number two, the cloud provider. And Google Cloud is also catching up. Most of the European market, I think Google Cloud has very good foothold. On top of it, there is Oracle Cloud, and then even there are some small companies like Rackspace and all that stuff. There are a lot of options over here. It's good to explore them, like what are the cloud providers and all that. The reason being, like even if any of you decide that you want to sit at home and start building something, right? I was just throwing an example of security camera, or maybe you decide to build another Ola or an Uber or something. You can just try out, like figure out what do you need, like for example, like what kind of clouds are the cheaper and everything. Okay. And most importantly, most of these clouds, they give almost close to an year free subscription. So you can explore on that one. Bhargav would walk you through the Amazon Web Service. And I saw a question, people asking, what are the prerequisites? Right now, the prerequisite is you just have a laptop and a browser. Pawan, next slide. Okay. So I was explaining, right, like AWS has a lot of components, these, that, and also how they would help you manage, like how cloud is taking care of some of the things, whether instead of organization taking to account. As you can see, there are so many AWS services that are available right now. AWS has their own analytics, called Metabase is one of them. And similarly, there are multiple analytics. So they provide the, based on the usage of your database, the performance and everything, you can get this analytics from that one. There are a bunch of business applications, customer enablement. We talked about this one like during our examples, and compute. Tomorrow also, there is going to be a session on the compute and storage. So I'll just skip those two for now. But the idea is compute and storage is basically being able to know what kind of storage you need and how much of load you want to maintain and those kind of things. And then containers is another thing that we talked about. Database, I'll skip this one too. Like I said, AWS or any, even Azure has their Microsoft related databases, AWS has RDS, DynamoDB and everything. Okay. And then coming to the part of application integration also, I did talk about that when I was explaining a little bit on DevOps, how the integration, the components that are available. So there are a bunch of them, like you'll see the EC2s and everything. Okay. And then like I even talked about the blockchain managed web services, how AWS kind of handles the standard components of it, where we have to build. Robotics is another component. So we'll be not dwelling too much in this workshop, but keep an eye on this one. And then customer engagement, security, identity, and compliance. We will be talking on the day three about this one. Developer tools, we will be talking about that. Like I said, I kind of explained earlier when I was talking through the DevOps in the programming and all that, what are the developer tools that are available. So when we look into the AWS account, like you'll see all the components. AWS cost management, which is like the pay-per-use kind of thing that we talked about. You'll see about this one also. So basically, depending on the kind of server you choose to use, the kind of storage space you take, the load balances you take and all that stuff will define the cost, and you can see that one too. And then in game development, that's another interesting aspect, like a robotics, maybe we're not touching it, but that can be something that there is a lot of standardization there. Internet of Things, this is another interesting component. So we talk about for example, like I was giving an example of security camera, right? I did talk about this. Security cameras come as part of this Internet of Things. For example, all the devices that you have, how do you use in connection with any of these programming languages would help build components on that one. So that's another interesting aspect, the Internet of Things, IoT. There are a lot of usages with this one. So basically, the moderation, like basically like so much of automation in the world that we are seeing right now, it all comes as part of this Internet of Things. It will be even able to gauge the weight of a truck before leaving the shipment facility and reaching the delivery, that there is no loss of the shipment, the things that were sent and all those kind of things. So it will be really helpful. Yeah, guys, if you have any questions, please post them. We'll answer them at the end in the Q&A session. Okay. And then we will networking and content delivery. We'll talk about networking as part of it. Media service also I kind of covered, giving the example of Netflix, Hotstar, and all that stuff. Mobile, I did talk about how Apple phone has revolutionized, or even the Android phones are taking it to the next level. The combination of all these technologies is what making. Machine learning, I did talk about this one also, like how you have to learn Python, how it can be taken to next level, become a part of machine learning or data scientist, how the data managing will be happening and all that stuff. So I kind of covered the machine learning aspect also. Quantum technologies, this is a really interesting one. There is a lot of innovation going on right now. The big organizations are deep into that. So basically, just to give what quantum technology is, like I think most of your faculty would be aware better than me. But if we have the quantum technology, it will be the revolution in the computer industry. Right now, it's a digital world with zeros and ones. Once we get to the quantum tech computing, there will be numbers in between, like 0.001 or something and all that. And imagine the kind of possibilities that it would bring onto the table. So these are all some of the components and everything. You'll learn a little by end of this 5 days. You'll feel good about yourself, like learning what is given by AWS and all that stuff. Next slide, Pawan. Okay, I hope right I'm on right on top of the hour. Or hope I didn't take too long to talk through.
It should be good in.
Over to you, Pawan. Maybe I can pass it.
Thank you, Karan. It's like you had introduced a lot of topics, terminologies to all the instructors and faculties. It will be very interesting because a lot of when you get introduced to so many terminologies, it takes time to digest. So that's how we plan the course is in day two, day three, day four, day five. We will talk about each of this terminology and go in deep detail. And apart from that, we will have a hands-on experience. So Bhargav, our lab assistant, is also on the call. And now Bhargav will show all of us like how to create an AWS account, which is a step one. For you to have a hands-on experience at your own time in your home or like colleges or somewhere around, just to get a good hands-on experience.
Yeah, and keep posting your questions, guys. We'll spend last 15 minutes answering as many questions as we can. Thanks, Paul.
So, Bharga, over to you, Bharga.
Hello, everyone. Let's have some hands-on experience on how to create an AWS account.
So Bharga, I'll make you a host such that you can share your screen.
Okay.
Yeah, I made you a host.
Yeah. To create an AWS account, enter aws.amazon.com, click enter. You will be prompted to the following page. Click on create an AWS account. Once you click on create an AWS account, you will be prompted to the following page. Enter your email address and password. Enter your account name. Then click on continue. Once you click on continue, you will be prompted to the following page. Select professional or personal. Enter your contact number. Select the country where you want to create your AWS account. Enter the address. Once you enter all these details, check mark this and click on create and continue. Once you click on create and continue, you will be prompted to the following payment page. This payment page is mandatory to give credit and debit card details. 2 rupees will be deducted from your account to create an AWS account completely, and you can give you will get 1 year free tier account. Once you enter all these details, within 24 hours AWS account will be created and you will get a confirmation email from AWS. I already have an AWS account. I'll just show you how to log in. By default, whenever you create an AWS account, you will be the root user. Click on root user. I'll explain you in detail in coming session what is IAM user. Click on next. Enter the password. Sign in. Once you sign into the page, you will be prompted to the following AWS console. In the left pane, you can find all the services with all the categories: compute, blockchain, analytics, storage, database, everything. And in this categories, you can find all the services. And in the right side, you can find all the regions. We have totally 24 regions, and I'll explain you in detail about what is a region.
Bharga, we lost your screen.
I'm just sharing another.
So the AWS, like before Bhargav keeps in, it offers a free account. So try to subscribe for your personal account, and a lot of services available for free. So for us to have this lab sessions on the first 7 days, so all this last 7 labs which we do is pretty much on the free tier. So you can get an hands-on experience. But in future, if you want to upgrade and do any computes like AI compute or anything else, yeah, everything is goes by charge per user. Go ahead.
Now let's see all the regions. AWS provides high quality global network performance with 76 availability zones in 245 countries and 216 points of presence. And it has 175 fully featured data centers globally. And it has 24 regions to support the customers across the world. Each region has multiple availability zones. And each and everyone is separated from one another and high redundancy networking. These availability zones offer easier and more effective design and operation of application and databases, ensuring high availability, fault tolerance, and scalability than traditional single data center infrastructure. These data centers are designed with custom progressive computer services, load balancers, routers, and storage services by using its own custom hardware. AWS provides the highest global reliability at the fastest pace of innovation, and all at the lowest cost. These are all the availability zones, blue color ones, which you can find here. That's it for the day.
Okay, so now we just saw how to create an AWS account. Please create AWS account for tomorrow's session, such that we have 2 labs for tomorrow. And regarding the Zoom app, I think we were like, we are using pretty much all this regular Zoom application, the latest one. And with respect to feedback link, we'll work on to provide a feedback link. I'll work with APSSTC to see how the, what is the process in providing day-to-day feedback. So now with this, we will we have another 15 minutes. We were all planning to make it more practical and interactive. So we would like to take questions and answers on this topic. So next 15 minutes, let's take Q&A. Can you please post the questions on Q&A session such that we can answer? Yeah, I do see 3 questions. So the very first question is about AWS free tier service. So how, what is this about and what kind of services we can use? And after 1 year, the card on file will be charged. Yes, AWS offers both, not only AWS, Azure, or even Google offers 1 year of free services. The whole point for us them to use it is like to get hands-on experience. At the same time, after 1 year, when you are like, it's charged, there's nothing like a charge until you use it. So after 1 year, you spin an instance and it is still, you are running it, then you need to go pay as you move. At the same time, Amazon also offers some educational services. So you, there's other ways you can request Amazon for extended free tier or have any kind of educational licenses. So the second question is on the attendance link. So generally what we do is like we pull attendee list from Zoom. So there's not explicit attendee list required. At Zoom will give us who attended and what. Let me go one by one on these questions. Can we know any programming languages for coming up days, 4 days? So DevOps or cloud is mostly relying, as Karun said, is like they have multiple language support. So we deal with more on AWS services than focuses on the building or developing any programming language skill. In the next 4 days, what you will do is create your own servers, create your own virtual private clouds, create your own network security groups, create your own database, like Postgres database, Dynamo database, create and then connect it from your local PG admin, like what you have in the colleges. And then at the same time in final session is like about, you will also learn about industry used monitoring solutions. So the intention of this is like, once you have hands-on experience, it's very easy for you to go back to your students and convey them like, okay, what type of tools they have. And each tool has a potential of like doing a college project or like an internship in-house. So, and as Karun said, if a student gets an experience on this kind of tools, it's very easy for them to build Hotstar kind of application without any investment, without much code, without any investment. If you think like you would like to build a Roku app or a Hotstar app, right? Amazon has all these services. So we would like to introduce you all these tools such that you will go back to the students and also convey them the same thing. Next question. What's the benefit to create an AWS account? It's, as we said, you will get access to the cloud. And because the whole point for us, right? Like, let's say when you are creating a Postgres database account, So options you have is you create on your local machine, like laptop, you create on your desktop, but you cannot expose your IP to the other person. So you will ask your lab assistant to create on the server network, but it is only limited to your internal network access. But if you want to build something for Hotstar or Netflix, so how do we get it? So as we are discussing more on cloud, services of cloud, and how to leverage cloud in a massive scale, how to start incubation centers within your colleges, how to start center of excellences within your colleges. So exposing to the cloud helps, and creation of account, of AWS account, helps you out to understand the ecosystem and start implementing in your respective colleges. Okay. So as this is purely a browser-driven, web-driven, internet-driven, right? Like, so all that we need, we expect is like have good internet, browser. And then account AWS account as Bhargav Show. And then you can log in subsequent sessions and create, just practice what we are trying to say in day two, day three, day four, day five. And I promise you by day five, you will be very confident in some of the AWS services. With respect to programming languages installed on the local machine, nothing is required on the local machine itself. So as we, that's the whole point of cloud. Oh yeah, the question is there any Indian company facilitate same type of services like AWS, Microsoft Azure? So I think if I'm understanding this correctly, the question is there any India incorporated company which offers, which is a cloud provider? I didn't see at the international scale, like the general cloud providers, what would you see is AWS, Azure, IBM, Google, Alibaba is the other one from Asia. But from India, I didn't see massive scale adoption. There may be some VPC clouds.
There are few VPC clouds like Octal IT Solutions. I think that's one of them. Like you said, the big players are obviously, I think in the Asian market is Alibaba is the biggest player. And I see that there's something called 2Deep Technologies, Alten, Callsoft Labs, and there are few players over there. Maybe like the example we talked about, right? Like on some of the small companies like Rackspace, or even smaller than that, like maybe mid-range, there are a few companies.
Exactly. There are players because that's a very, all the companies right now, there's a statistics, right? By 2021, this year, 55% of all the companies in India are already using multiple cloud providers. So it's a big market, multi-trillion market. When there is like a demand, there is always the provider. But on the global scale, when you see outside India, like at the global scale, I wish like I'm expecting some company to evolve from India at the massive scale. So the question is about, can we show AWS account creation again? This video is recorded, ma'am. Like you can go back and do it. If not, like if you have time again, I can walk through differently. So the question, okay, let me read the other questions, what we have.
If possible, show us hosting PHP.
Sir, if you forgot to shut down a service, it runs continuously. We are charged extra amount. Yeah, so there are services where you can write a little script, Dr. Kalyan Garu, where if the services are beyond certain point, you can put checks and balances within Amazon. You can see like what services are running and you can write some scripts which auto shutdowns. So even if you are running it, you can write some triggers where it can auto shutdown. Yeah, Sai, this is a good question. Sir, how could cloud services feature FX AI field today's industry? If you see on Amazon, because we are talking about Amazon now, there are many services like Amazon Recognition, Amazon Lex, AI is everywhere, right? Now we are already seeing applied AI. Our car is Tesla, it drives by itself. Our phone, we are talking to Google or like Siri, right? So and Google Home or Alexa. So in with respect to Amazon services, there are some good services where it has it helps you to build applied AI's applications and for students also it's projects. Something like Recognition, AWS Recognition, where you do surveillance camera and you detect people, right? Like you do image analysis or you do photo analysis. There you use AWS Recognition. The other one is on where you are talking and it needs to convert into text. So you use services like Amazon Transcribe. So it automatically converts you into text. The other AI services you translate from one language to another language, like Telugu to Hindi, Hindi to like translator. You have AWS Translate. The other service you also have is like on like automatic caller assistance or Alexa. So that's called AWS Lex, where you are able to talk and it will be able to respond as a human. So there's like, yes, the cloud, it definitely helps AI to scale because AI is always about processing and cloud is like a backbone for AI development because it gives you enormous processing. And you are seeing already in Flipkart and other real world applications right now, you see Amazon recommendation or Flipkart, they mine petabytes of data to give you a recommendation saying that, hey, you bought this, do you also interested in buying this? That's let's take another question. I hope I answered your Sagar. What makes different from other cloud centers like IBM? Each company has its own cloud center. Exactly. So you want to take this one, Karan?
Yeah.
What makes different from other cloud? Basically, what their question is about, there are different cloud providers. What is the quality of service differs and how they are different?
So it's a very interesting question. Like I was talking about, right? Like portability also was one aspect. So overall, if you look, most of the clouds are pretty much the same. It all depends on the service provided by the particular company. For example, the reason in AWS is more popular because of the customer support and the scalability. Their customer support is really quick. So that's one of the things. And then again, the scalability aspect, like obviously most of the providers also will be decided based on the pricing. So that's one aspect. And other is, for example, Microsoft. If you take the Microsoft cloud, it's a no-brainer for the companies that are using all the Microsoft components from the beginning. For example, if the company was building all its applications using .NET, or maybe they're using the MS SQL, like the Microsoft SQL. So those kind of companies, like by default, they go to the Microsoft, and it's a no-brainer because they don't have to change anything. So that kind of creates a dependency on them. And the other thing, like I was talking about Oracle, right? The Oracle is just catching up because they're late entry into the cloud market. Most of the companies already moved. But one of the reason why Oracle Cloud is getting the traction that it is right now, because all the bigger organizations were using Oracle database. And it becomes no-brainer to directly go into the Oracle Cloud where the infrastructure will be taken care of. And similarly to your question, IBM Cloud, there is a huge surge on that one when it comes to the two components in IBM. One, IBM Watson is one of the components, like it's an AI tool, but there is a lot of traction in the market. And second thing is blockchain we were talking about, right? There are a lot of companies that are building blockchain wallets and everything. For example, they use something called Hyperledger to build these components. And Hyperledger is managed by IBM. So the default solution to go, when you go with any of these solutions, IBM Bluemix is the name of the cloud. If I remember correctly. So you'll go to that one. So it's based on the need that you have and the infrastructure that's already existing and the kind of programming languages that you are into will define this one. If you are a startup company, I think it will come down to the pricing and the availability aspects.
The other question is, can I able to learn how to create a private cloud? Yes, sir. So tomorrow's session will be how to create. Today is like creation of account, very basic. Tomorrow we will learn about how to create users, like create your organization or colleges, right? Like network groups. In doing that, you will make sure that you create a virtual private cloud for yourself or your organization, such that it's protected within yourself, right? Once you have an organization, then you will say like faculty groups, student groups, and then like IT admin group. You create different groups, you create different users there, you assign them security policies. That's what we are going to talk about tomorrow. Yes, to your point, we will show you how to create VPCs. And the other private cloud, what we also talked about is like on the VMware side. We are not touching anything on VMware as today is more on, this session is more on the Amazon services. The other question is, if possible, showing us a hosting PHP MySQL website in AWS. Basically, what they are asking is, they would love to have an AWS or a PHP application hosted in AWS. Yes, so we are on the day five. We are planning to show you like basically how we deploy a Java stack. We are planning to use show you Beanstalk in this session, which means like on multiple clicks, how do you make sure that your servers of Apache and everything is getting ready and your LAMP stack like PHP or MySQL is available up and running. Hope I answered that question. Next is about Please select the account type. Yeah, it's personal. When you are creating an account, try to create a personal account. As a faculty, how for AWS can be helpful for students? It's a good question, sir. Manash. So one is, right, you are taking the student to altogether next generation, and which is very practical. On day one of his job, this is what he's going to sign up for. Second thing is, as we all discussed, the power of cloud is within your organization or within your college, you can build a center of excellence. And the projects which students are struggling for, right, third year projects or fourth year projects or internships, those projects can be very much in real time. So they can either build Hotstar kind of application, they can build a surveillance camera where it parses images, or they can build a next big thing like IoT monitoring agricultural plants. So the good thing of cloud is most of the services are free and they are already available, especially on the AI side. As I said, right, voice communication search or voice to speech, speech to voice, or any kind of those kind of services, it's very difficult at the institution level to build NLP and train the NLP model. But if you are using cloud like Amazon Lex, your conversation app, your student can build it in less than 100 lines of code, whether he is from EEE branch, EC branch, or computer science. It's nothing about the background. It's about how he interfaces it. And that's, again, coming back to Jeff Bezos' quote, which Karun said is, right, everyone in the industry is assuming the next $1 billion companies are coming from colleges. Because 10 years back, when me and Karun, or 18 years back when we started, to do a startup, we need to spend thousands and thousands of dollars on buying these servers. But now, if you have a good idea, you can use Amazon kind of cloud services, and there is no stopping. There's nothing that stops people. So said that, right, it gives enormous flexibility to build real-world applications. And India is a big country with a lot of opportunities. Having exposed students on cloud definitely helps them out to scale big and make next generation applications. With this, we almost reached top of our 1232. We'll make it as interactive as possible. There is a Slack channel which already posted on it. You can ask us the questions, and APSSG has also created WhatsApp groups. We are active. Me and Karun work in US time zones. We are both from Dallas, and Bhargav and Charan will be on the Indian time zone. So they are available. So you pretty much have like some of the other one from us who round the clock answers your questions. Yeah, and we do provide day-wise video. Right now, it's already been streamed in your Facebook. So you can go back today session, and in our page, like, you can see back and parse through the Facebook videos. With this...
Pound, do you want to take one last question? I see an interesting question. Maybe it can... How can machine learning help in AWS for optimizations?
Yeah, especially the last question, what we'll take is, one is on the compute side, it helps you a lot on reducing the cost. On optimization or performance side, right, especially when you are building anything like text processing, image processing, or video processing, you can leverage the skill and the model, which is already been built by Amazon with petabytes of data. And one best thing is about you are paying only pay as you go model. So it's not expensive. You pay for whatever the model you have. With this, we come to a conclusion on day one. I hope you guys enjoy this. If you have any feedback, I think I'm there in all the WhatsApp groups. Me, Karun, Charan, everyone is there in the WhatsApp groups. You can send us a personal message. You can send us a group message. We are happy to change because we are coming from IT background, not faculty background, right? So if there is any tweaks we need to make in day two, day three, day four, please let us know. We will try to adjust our sessions accordingly. Thank you all. Thanks for a wonderful day.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.